Hi everyone. Today in this video we are going to discuss about escitalopram. What is this drug escitalopram? This is one of the SSRI selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, and within the name we can observe the prefix ES, which indicates this drug is a S-isomer of citalopram. Citalopram is again SSRI, which is available as racemic mixture. Both R-isomer as well as S-isomer is present, and within these the pure S-isomer of citalopram is nothing but S-citalopram. So today in this video we are going to discuss how this drug acts, where the stereoactive center is present, what are the precautions, side effects and clinical use of escitalopram we will discuss in this video. This drug is useful in the treatment of major depressive disorder, commonly known as depression. Similarly, this drug is also useful in the treatment of generalized anxiety disorder. Generalized anxiety disorder is one of the conditions in the patient where anxiety is observed at many of the situations without any proper reason. In such conditions, escitalopram can be used. But the main use of this drug is in the treatment of major depressive disorder, which is associated with few of the depressive symptoms such as irritability, pessimism, feeling of guilt, apathy, lack of initiation, restlessness and insomnia, lack of sleep. Both psychological as well as biological symptoms are present in the major depressive disorder. In such conditions, escitalopram can be used both in the adults as well as adolescents. What is the chemical nature of this drug? So this is the structure of escitalopram, and here one of the heterocyclic ring system is present. This is nothing but benzofuran. So escitalopram is a benzofuran derivative, and we can observe a stereoactive center at the first position. So this structure is available as both R isomer as well as S isomer, but escitalopram is the pure S isomer of this structure. How it acts? Just we have seen that escitalopram acts by inhibition of the serotonin reuptake. So this is the presynaptic neuron which is storing 5-HT, and this is the postsynaptic neuron which is equipped with postsynaptic receptors such as 5-HT2 receptors. Now when the action potential reaches to the presynaptic neurons, the calcium can enter into the presynaptic nerve terminals, which results in the calcium mediated exocytosis and release of the serotonin. This serotonin can bind to 5-HT2 receptors, thereby can produce postsynaptic stimulation. So the postsynaptic action depends on the 5-HT levels within the synaptic cleft. But what about the released 5-HT can also be taken into the nerve terminals by one of the transporter SERT, serotonin reuptake transporter. So this transporter is having the two important sites. This is the primary site and this is the allosteric site. Now the 5-HT can be reuptaken through this SERT through primary as well as allosteric sites. In this way, the 5-HT which is going to be released can act on the postsynaptic receptors. At the same time, it can be reuptaken into the nerve terminal, which is again stored into the vesicles. Now here, escitalopram inhibits this SERT serotonin reuptake transporter, but this drug is having the two binding sites. It can bind to the primary site as well as it can bind to the allosteric site. By binding to both of these sites, escitalopram can inhibit the reuptake of 5-HT. Now the 5-HT cannot be reuptaken into the nerve terminal because of this block produced by escitalopram, and this results in the increased 5-HT levels within the synaptic cleft. And as the 5-HT levels are increased, they can also affect the autoinhibitory presynaptic receptors. Within the presynaptic neurons, we can observe another type of receptors. These are the 5-HT1 receptors, which are autoinhibitory in nature. They can inhibit the release of 5-HT from the presynaptic neurons. Now, when these 5-HT levels are excessively increased, they can produce the desensitization of these 5-HT1 receptors, which results in the further pharmacological actions of escitalopram. In this way, this drug produces pharmacological actions by blocking the serotonin reuptake as well as by desensitization of the autoinhibitory 5-HT1 receptors. What are the precautions? One of the important precautions of escitalopram is that this drug can increase the angle closure glaucoma, ACG. So this is one of the conditions where there is increased levels of intraocular pressure because of the decreased drainage of aqueous humor. In such conditions, if any drug further increase in the intraocular pressure may increase the glaucoma. Here, escitalopram increase the pupillary dilatation, and when this pupillary dilatation is increased, it can cause the narrowing of canal of Sclam, which is the drainage channel for aqueous humor. So when this is going to be narrowed, it increase the accumulation of aqueous humor, resulting in the increased intraocular pressure. So in the patients already having angle closure glaucoma, if escitalopram is given, it can further increase the glaucoma, resulting in blurred vision as well as loss of vision. Similarly, another important precaution is that escitalopram can increase the serotonin syndrome. So this is one of the syndrome observed with many of the drugs such as SSRIs and SNRIs. So this syndrome produces few of the symptoms such as agitation, hallucinations, confusion, anxiety, tachycardia, hyperthermia, the increased body temperature, diaphoresis, increased sweating, flushing, increased vasodilatation, tremor, and muscle rigidity. All these symptoms can be precipitated by escitalopram, and particularly this syndrome is observed when this escitalopram is given with other drugs which are again increase the serotonin syndrome. Particularly MAO inhibitors, when they are given with the escitalopram, they can produce serotonin syndrome. Similarly, escitalopram can also reduce the cognitive as well as motor performance in the patients. So when this drug is prescribed, it can produce decreased skills like decreased judgment, decreased thinking, and it can also reduce the motor activities, motor skills, which may result in the poor driving performance. So this drug should be carefully given in the elders because of motor as well as cognitive impairment. Another important precaution of this drug is that this drug can increase the risk of bleeding. On prolonged use, this drug can increase the epistaxis, nasal bleeding, hematoma, increased spreading of the blood outside the blood vessels, gastrointestinal bleeding. All this can be observed with the escitalopram on prolonged use. And particularly this risk is further increased with other drugs like aspirin, which is an antiplatelet agent, warfarin, which is an oral anticoagulant, similarly NSAIDs, which also increase the risk of bleeding. All these drugs, when they are co-administered with escitalopram, they can further increase the risk of bleeding. So they should be carefully prescribed with the escitalopram. Another important precaution is that this drug can increase the suicidal initiation. It can produce few of the symptoms in the patient such as anxiety, agitation, irritability, and insomnia. Along with these symptoms, it can also increase the suicidal thoughts, particularly in the adolescents with age less than 18 years, and in the young patients with age 18 to 24 years, risk of suicidal initiation is more observed. So this drug should be carefully given in the adolescents and young patients in order to prevent this suicidal initiation. And escitalopram can also increase the risk of seizures. So if already patient is having any risk of induction of seizures, in such patients, this drug should be carefully given. And since this is an antidepressant, this drug can produce two phases within the patients. It can produce either mania or hypomania. That means it can produce some hyperactive disorder or depressive disorder. Since in the central nervous system, it is a sensitive balance, this drug may stimulate the symptoms of either mania or hypomania. And this drug can also increase the QTC interval, the corrected QT interval. So care should be taken in the cardiovascular patients in order to prevent fatal cardiac arrhythmias. Another important precaution of this drug is that this drug can produce hyponatremia, decreased sodium levels within the body. The serum sodium levels may be reduced less than 110 millimoles per liter. So this condition produces few of the symptoms such as headache, confusion, impaired memory, weakness, and all these effects of escitalopram are mainly due to decreased action of antidiuretic hormone. So when this hormone is not working, it increases the diuresis and loss of sodium, resulting in the hyponatremia. Few of the conditions in the patients like volume depletion or patients who are taking diuretics, similarly in the elders, there may be an increased risk of hyponatremia when this escitalopram is given. What are the side effects? Important side effects mainly include dry mouth, dizziness, sweating, indigestion, constipation, abdominal pain, and it can also produce fatigue, ejaculation disorders, which may lead to impotence, rhinitis, nausea, and some loss of libido can be observed in the patients. How it is given? This drug is available as a tablet as well as orally disintegrating tablet. Both film coated tablet as well as orally disintegrated tablets are available, and this drug is also available as a solution. The dose of this drug for major depressive disorder is initiated at a dose of 10 mg once daily. The dose can be increased based on the symptoms in the patients, but these increments should be done at least after 1 week of the treatment. The dose can be increased up to 20 mg once daily, but this increment should be slow in the adolescents with age less than 18 years. In the adolescents, after 3 weeks of the treatment only, the increment should be done in order to prevent unwanted effects of escitalopram. Similarly, for the treatment of generalized anxiety disorder, again the dose is initiated at 10 mg once daily, and after 1 week of the treatment, the increments can be done based on the situation, and the dose can be increased up to 20 mg once daily. So that's about this escitalopram, which is a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, and this is the S-isomer of citalopram. This drug mainly inhibits the serotonin reuptake transporter, and it binds to the both primary site as well as allosteric site. Thereby, it inhibits the reuptake of 5-HT, which increase the 5-HT levels within the synaptic cleft, resulting in the antidepressant activity. The raised 5-HT levels within the synaptic cleft may also desensitize the autoinhibitory 5-HT1 receptors, which is also responsible for antidepressant activity. This drug should be carefully given to the patients who are having angle closure glaucoma and the patients who are suffering with seizures. And this drug may increase the suicidal initiation, particularly in the young and adolescent patients. It can precipitate the serotonin syndrome because of increased 5-HT levels. It can also increase the risk of bleeding and cognitive as well as motor impairment. This drug can reduce the antidiuretic hormone activity, thereby it can produce hyponatremia. All these factors should be considered before this escitalopram is prescribed. And this drug can also increase the QT interval, so it may precipitate fatal cardiac arrhythmias. So care should be taken when this drug is prescribed to cardiovascular patients. And finally, this drug can produce either manic or hypomanic phase because of fluctuations of 5-HT levels. This drug is available as a film-coated tablet or orally disintegrating tablet as well as solution. For both major depressive disorder as well as generalized anxiety disorder, the initial dose is 10 mg once daily. The dose can be incremented after 1 week of treatment, and based on the condition, the dose may be increased up to 20 mg per day. But in the adolescents, the dose increment should be done after 3 weeks of the treatment. So that's about this escitalopram, which is the S-isomer of citalopram. So that's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comment in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.